name's Mark Ross. I'm with an organization called Rock Here. Some of you may have seen our booth here at summer camp over the last 8 years. There are other festivals around the country. One of the things we like to do with artists at different festivals is we like to have these social change through music discussions and interviews and performances with artists that are involved in social, political, environmental, philanthropic endeavors. And I have to say, I've been a Mo fan for a long time, and Mo, over their 20-plus year history, is known for not just creating great music and great shows and awesome albums and being awesome people, but they've also been known for their philanthropy, their charity, taking political stands, being involved in other environmental and social issues. And so those are the types of bands that we like to feature, the bands we like to work with. And with that, I'd like to introduce all of you to Chuck Garvey. Yes, sir. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Chuck.
I'm Chuck.
Oh, what next?
You want to play a song?
Yes.
Where did it finish? Come again, Jake, where does the
Just like feeling like you can do whatever you want. So we started writing our own songs, and regardless of whether or not we thought it was the right or good thing to do, it was fun. So that's always been the best part about writing music is, you know, it's, you can call it your own. It's a lot more fun than playing covers all the time. I like playing covers, you know. I don't know a guitar player who doesn't like playing Led Zeppelin songs, right? Or Beatles, you know. So, but it's fun to write your own music and even fail at doing it every once in a while, you know. Then you learn what people like and what you really like. So I've been a fan of that. It's hard to write music though, and I'm pretty stingy about it. So it takes a couple years per song. I think. It's not quite that bad.
Do you remember what some of the first songs you were? Some of the first songs you wrote were?
Yeah, there was a song. I just like the name, the sound of this. There's this town in upstate New York called Messina, and I wrote like this, like really kind of, you know, what I thought was like this catchy radio song, and you know, so that was like one of the first things that I wrote for Mo. The other stuff, it was all just hobby stuff, so they didn't really have names, you know, they were like project number six, you know. And it was just, they were just kind of like practice tapes. But, yeah, the first stuff was just for fun, just to like kind of sound like my heroes, you know, like kind of Steely Dan sounding stuff and stuff that you'd hear on the radio. And then eventually, like, I started listening to more blues and some crazier like rock music, like King Crimson. And that's the stuff that really got me excited. You know, Talking Heads and stuff like that.
Hey, in terms of your songwriting process, I'm sure it's involved and I'm sure it changes song to song. But typically, is it the tune first in your head, or you get a lyric line in your head and you build a song around that?
I think it happens in a bunch of different ways, but usually, like there are some lyric ideas that kind of brew for a long time, and then there's like a bunch of like little fiddly instrumental stuff that I work on, and then every once in a while you realize that you can put the two things together, or like you've had the instrumental part for such a long time, I just say I gotta write words for this, you know, just finish it. So it happens a bunch of different ways.
You guys want to hear another song?
I have to retune quickly. Hold on, just a second. Feel that dead air.
So everybody, stay nice and cool out there.
How about that weather?
Just means we're gonna have a really, really, really hot show.
That's a perfect example. That song, Brain Tubo, is just like this little thing that was kind of funny to play, and Mo just, you know, Rob, we were talking about brain tumor, brain tuba. I don't know exactly how it went, but that's how the song got named.
So start playing it again!
It's just like this little fiddly thing, and I don't know. Maybe we'll maybe turn it into a real song one of these days. It was never much of a song. It was just kind of this funny time killer. This next song I wrote for a Halloween show that we did a couple of years ago, and we had fans pick the theme for the Halloween show, which is the Electric Lemonade Acid Test. Everybody in the band wrote their own song, you know, to contribute to the night's music, and this is the song that I wrote for it. And I wrote the music first, and then I wrote like 85% of the lyrics on a plane ride. I didn't have my computer, I didn't have a book, I didn't have anything, and all of a sudden I wrote out like 2.5 verses really fast. I was like, oh, cool, you know, I got a new song, and it didn't take a year, so. So I'll play that. This is like the alternate acoustic version of Suck a Lemon.
Yeah.
You guys were involved in a benefit in New York City in Roseland. You want to talk a little bit about how that came together and what kind of good came out of that?
After the first real big tsunami event, Mo had some time off, and we decided that because we have a fan base and good music fans who we know would come out and support it, we just wanted to help raise money because that's like one of the things that we can do for the benefit of others rather than just kind of working on our own thing. And luckily, we have, over the years, we've made a lot of great friendships, and we were able to ask people like John Modesty and Trey Cannonplay, Chad Hartswick,
Sam Bush.
Sam Bush is awesome. He's such a great guy.
We love you, Sam.
Yeah, wherever you are. Ray Kaczkowski, Trey's band. Leave anybody out. But anyway, we did that at Roseland in New York City, and we ended up raising a lot of money that night, and David Matthews matched all of the money. I think it's called Bama Works. It's his charitable foundation, and he matched every dollar, so we managed to raise a lot of money to give to the Red Cross. A lot of music fans came out, and I think we may have even had a food drive at that thing, at that event as well, so it's, you know, we're all going to get together and have fun with music regardless, so why not raise some money for a charity and just about anything else you can do to help other people out if you can. So anytime we have a chance to do that, and all of us have things that happen in our lives, like a family member might get sick, or people are in need in other places, and we're in a very good position where we can actually do something about it. So,
and because of you guys, that could happen because you guys are the ones who pay the money to make all that stuff work. So it's really cool that you guys all support not only us, but our causes that we are involved in.
We donate our time, and we get, you know, other people to help out. And Marco Benevento is another person who played there. Marco is awesome. And it's great, you know, having a community like this where people are willing to do that. The musicians and the people who come to see us play, so we're very fortunate.
And you guys, that was 2005, you guys kind of went on a little mini charity tear. It was in 2006, and you did the Kelberman Center benefit. And how did that come about? Because that sounds like it made it a little bit more personal to the band.
Yeah, the Kelberman Center they work on autism issues and autism education for autistic kids, and that place is a multi-million dollar facility, and they really needed the help, and
it's really dear to Al's heart. He has a daughter that has autism, so, you know, whenever there's something that one of us is very passionate about, we kind of all are passionate about it, you know, we're all one big family, so for us to be able to help Al support the Kelberman Center and raise a bunch of money to help out with autism, which is, you know, a big issue nowadays with children, more so every year, you know, it's a very, you know, very good cause.
And more recently, from an environmental standpoint, you guys have also been active on that front, both with the Rainforest Action Network, as well as, I know that we were talking just before this session about the proposed idea of fracking in upstate New York. But let's talk about the Rainforest Action track first. You guys got involved with Patagonia. They did a series of releases through iTunes for different charities, and Rock the Earth was one of those charities. How did Rainforest Action come about?
How did we come to pick them? We had chosen a couple of different charities, and we decided that we wanted to do something that everybody was on board with, and that's definitely environmental issues are all of us share that regardless of anything else that happens in our lives. The whole band is just on board with maintaining a beautiful planet and a good place to live and a healthy place to live. So, you know, that's kind of a no-brainer. We worked with World Hunger Year. They're another example of a no-brainer. You know, every person on Earth deserves to be able to get clean drinking water and some food, you know, and shelter. Those are the basic things that everyone needs. So every once in a while, a cause like that is just presents itself, or someone brings it up, and we're just like, yes, let's do that. That's the thing that we're going to be working on right now, and just try and make people aware, or try and raise money, do everything that we can. So Rainforest Action Network was the charity that we chose for the Patagonia project, where they had a bunch of, they asked a lot of musicians to donate songs, and each band got to choose their own charity, and Rainforest Action was just the one that all of us said, yes, that's what we want to do. So.
And of course, as you talked about earlier, upstate New York is really the genesis of the band, and some of the band is still doing this. And obviously, one of the probably biggest environmental issues of our time in recent memory is this thing called fracking, which is hydraulic fracturing, which is a drilling process involved in natural gas drilling,
yeah,
for
that.
The most part. And we were talking earlier, what's going on in upstate New York? What should everyone know?
It's in the papers all the time, basically. There's been moratoriums in the Marcellus Shale pit for a while. Marcellus Shale, it's like one of the largest shale croppings in the world. And there's tons of natural gas in it, so they want it. They want it all. And there's been moratorium after moratorium that just stopped the fracking in the Marcellus Shale pits. And they've been doing a lot of research, with research and lobbies and all that, there's a lot of money getting put in by the oil companies to say, it's all good, it's all cool. And there's a lot of people in New York that say, no, it's not all good. So they've been kind of holding it up and saying, we got to study it more now. But now, the last few things I've read about, they're pitching the Governor Cuomo to just ban it all together, so the Marcellus shit can't get touched. So, whether or not that happens, we all know how politics works, and money talks a lot of times, but there's enough people behind it that hopefully, and Governor Cuomo so far has been pretty good about environment, a lot of issues in New York State, so hopefully he takes the high road and puts the ban on, it'd be great.
Yeah, fracking is kind of a quick and dirty process where they open up these pockets underground, and it can have these far-reaching effects where it actually cracks the ground, and this trapped natural gas, which is, there's a lot of it, and it's worth a lot of money, and we can use it for power and cooking and whatever else you want to use natural gas for. But if, as a result of this process, the toxic nature of natural gas seeps into the drinking water, and it can really foul the soil. Upstate New York is a lot of farmland, just like Pennsylvania, a lot of other northeast states. Yeah, you probably have the same thing here. But if that happens and it goes wrong, which is extremely possible, the water supply for all of New York State, possibly New York City, could be ruined. And that's a huge thing that a lot of people depend on. So it's tough to like demonize something like that, but at the same time, you can't just let it happen without really considering the consequences. So it's one thing that we just want to bring awareness to.
And also, I just read in a paper recently that right now, natural gas is real cheap because we have way too much of it. They don't even have places to store all that we're getting right now. So why would you even open up the Marcellus Shale pits when we already have enough? We have so much right now that they can't keep the price up, which they'd like to do, but they can't, it's too much. So,
I grew up in New York State. Vinnie grew up in, we grew up in Central New York. It's beautiful.
Saranac!
I love the Adirondacks. I spent most of my childhood going back and forth between central New York and way northern upstate New York, and it's beautiful up there, and I want to maintain that for as long as possible. I don't know if it's selfish, but I think it's something that we kind of have to try and keep as pure as possible for as long as possible.
Yeah. What do you think, another song?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Pretty much on the foothills of the Adirondacks. When I get home, I don't need I've been all over the world. There's not a better place in the world than there. Put a nice pool in my backyard and built a nice basement, and I just stay at home. I got two beautiful kids, a beautiful wife, and nothing that recharges me more than actually being home. So I don't go anywhere else, ever.
For me, when I go home, that is my happy place. So I stay there as long as possible. I live in Chicago, and I've been there for 12 years, and it's really fantastic. And there's never an end to what you could do there and possibilities. And just going to the lake and sitting there, and you have a city to your back, and then you look out and there's nothing. So it's a good Zen spot.
One last question, and I ask this of every artist I ever have on my panels or that I work with at any of the festivals, and that's, what's one thing that everybody here can take home with them and do that will make this world a better place? And it can be anything, it doesn't have to be environmental. Just one thing people can do to make this world a better place. Vinnie?
Most of these people already know it, but like, you come to a festival like this, there's 10, 15, 20,000 people, right? Size of a lot of towns or cities, right? There's no politicians running it, and there's nobody really fighting or, yeah, everybody kind of gets along and we're all here for the same reason. So just take that back to wherever you live and, you know, try to make that happen wherever you live, you know? So get everybody living together and hanging out and not having stress and fighting and arguing and all that shit that always happens. Just do what you do here back home, you know? So make everybody your friend and hang out. You know, you guys are all good at that already because you come to a lot of these things and you see how it works. So if you can bring that home to your town and try to get people at the grocery store to feel the same way, or people in your local school district or wherever you hang out, whatever it is, you know, I think that will do everybody a little bit of good.
Check out the big brain on Vinnie. Awesome.
For me, the one thing I think I would get out of every festival experience that I get out of is trying to be more open-minded. I go in thinking, you know, like, and I have a terrible band name. Like, it's the worst band name ever. There's times where I see bands and I go, that's a shitty band name. I shouldn't even check it out. And I should know better than that. And I remember that every time, like, just to be more open-minded to anything and not make your mind up before you have a sample.
Don't judge a band by their name. I like it.
You guys want to play some music? We've got a few minutes left.
Thank you.
Get your cell phones over to the Rock Your Booth. Thanks very much. We'll see you guys later.